Welcome everyone to Medieval Dynasty, and the first in a series of video where I'm going to share with you the information I wish I would have known when I got started in the game. In my case, I went through a few different playthroughs where I would learn a little bit about different things and then realize that, hey, had I known that information I just learned, I would have done things differently from the very beginning. So hopefully I can shortcut that process for you and get you going in the right direction from the start. Now that we know a little bit about the game itself, let's get started in a brand new game. So I'm going to click on New Game, and we have two choices. The first choice is I could simply hop right into the game world using the game defaults for all of the gameplay elements. However, I highly recommend spending a little bit of time in the Customize tab, simply because this is going to give you a lot of options. If you're the type of person that wants to, if maybe you already know there are certain gameplay elements that you want to focus on and others that you don't care at all about and you just assume ignore, well, the Customize tab is where you're going to have the ability to set those options before you start the game. So let's take a few moments and run through some of these and give you an idea of what exactly you can customize. Starting at the very top is one of the most important decisions to make, and that is the length of each season. And that is because this game is not intended to play through in its entirety as the same character. As the name Dynasty would imply, one of the things you're going to do in this game is you can choose to get married and have an heir. And that heir will need to reach the age of 18. Once that your heir is 18 years of age, should something happen and your player character die, you will simply move on and your new player character will become that heir. And then it goes on from generation to generation. So this isn't the type of gameplay that you're meant to get everything done in 15 or 20 hours. It's intended to be a much longer playthrough than that over many generations. But keep in mind, your player character can die in a few different ways. And we'll talk about that a little bit more as we get into today's video, as well as some of the future videos. But to suffice it to say, you can die of old age, obviously a common way to die. And that's the way you hopefully will die, because the other ways to die are from temperature. For example, during the winter, you could freeze to death if you don't have the proper clothing to keep your character warm, as well as things like fires to keep you warm. Also, with wild animals in the game, such as bears, wolves, and wild boar, if they attack you and you're unable to defend yourself, then that's going to be the end of your player character. And with no heir of proper age, then your gameplay is over. So the length of the season is going to have a huge impact on that. Four seasons during every year, and the length of each of those seasons is going to lengthen the gameplay. The faster the years clock by, the faster you get to future generations. So keep that in mind. I do believe that 3 days is plenty of time to get everything done that you might need to do within a specific season. For example, if you're heavily into farming, well, each season is going to have certain crops that you can plant and or harvest during that particular season. And if you miss your opportunity, then it's gone. A lot of the other things in the game, such as hunting, you can do year round. But so the length of each season is going to determine how much you can get done or how much the NPCs that you invite to your village can get done during that time. Moving on now to taxes. So when you start building in this game, you don't have to pay for the land. Instead, you pay taxes on what you build on the land. So every house that you build for yourself or an NPC will have a certain amount of taxes that you will owe on that every game year. Other buildings, such as production buildings or gathering buildings, everything has a certain tax associated with it. So the more buildings you have, the bigger your tax bill is going to be in the spring of each year. So you have to keep that in mind, because that means you're going to need ways of making money. And one of the videos in this series will be dedicated specifically to ways to make money in the early and mid game. Building limits. Building limits as well as population limits are tied to something called dynasty reputation, which again, we'll get into more later on that, especially in future videos. But dynasty reputation is easily obtained by doing some of the basic quests available into the game called chapters, but they're not really very difficult to do, and there's no hurry in doing them. You can take as long as you want in completing those, and it is definitely recommended to grow your settlement at a slow pace. Growing very quick can allow you to encounter a lot of problems that you're going to have some difficulty overcoming. So it's definitely recommended to not push the building limits too hard, especially early on in the game as you're getting used to exactly what type of resources you're going to need and how much of them you're going to need. Then we come to events. These are random things that will happen generally when you're moving between season. So for example, if you're moving from spring to summer, one of the random events might be that a storm came through and damaged some of your buildings. So you're going to have to go and do repair work on those buildings. Also, maybe you've had some terrible weather and it has cost you some resources. So you might have to, and it'll show you a list of the resources that you have lost due to different storm activities. And so you're going to have to recoup those resources. Different things like that will happen, some good, some bad, and you can choose whether or not you want that as part of your game. Then you come to the survival part of this. So let's say that you decide you don't want to play this game as a survival game. You're just not interested in that. You want to focus on just simply hunting for fun, or maybe you want to turn this into a pure city builder. Well, you can turn off your health, your stamina, hunger, and thirst. So you won't have to deal with any of that. In fact, my main playthrough right now is exactly that. I've turned off these options because I wanted to focus entirely on building my settlement in over time so that it could be as big as possible. And I simply didn't want to deal with having to worry about my own needs. I wanted to focus on the needs of my settlers. So that's an option. And one of the most famous options, especially if you're familiar with RPGs and open world type games where you're doing a lot of crafting and a lot of gathering of materials, you deal with weight issues. You become encumbered, and then you either can't move at all or you move very slowly. Well, in this game, you have the option to turn that off completely should you so decide. Then you get into your inhabitants, your villagers, the NPCs in the game world. Once they join your village, they're going to need wood and food, among other things, as time goes on. But how much of this do you want them to need? Again, by default, it's going to be 100%. You can choose to increase the difficulty by having them require more food. That's going to put more of a stress on you and the villagers in order to provide that food. Same thing with the wood. Wood is used as firewood in order to keep them warm during the year. And of course, you're going to need more firewood during the winter than you're going to need during the summer. But you can increase or decrease those needs. And we're definitely going to talk about this one in particular in a future video where we really focus on starting your village and then building it up from the very beginning. Then you get into the food spoilage. By default, things like meat that you might get from hunting or different crops such as the fruits and vegetables, they're going to spoil over time. If you hold these over multiple seasons, they will spoil and then eventually they will ruin entirely. But you can choose whether or not you want that to be a part of your game. Then we come to the animals in the game. This is referring to the wild animals. As I mentioned earlier, some of the animals will do damage. Some will attack you immediately upon sight. Others won't attack you until you attack them first. But this is all about how much damage they do and how hard it is to kill them. So again, something that you can make easier or harder depending on what type of playthrough you're looking for. Then we get into the last couple of options, poisoning. This would be if you eat bad food, food that is already rotten. This can happen if you pick berries that grow in the wild during the wrong season and eat them at the wrong time. There are things in the game world that grow that you can pick and consume that will help offset some of this, as well as gain you XP and certain things. So it's not the end of the world if you do get food poisoning, but it is something to be aware of. And then finally, temperature, something we talked about a little bit earlier. The temperature in the game world will vary based on the season, and you need to make sure you have the clothing that is appropriate for that particular season. So with these game options out of the way, let's hop into the game world and just see what the very beginning is like. So we've just spawned into a brand new game. What do we do now? Well, you've got tons of options, as I alluded to earlier in the video, but a few things to make note of. Number one is you spawn on a path, and as you come to the different crossroads where paths will intersect and splinter off from one another, you're going to see signs that will take you to the different villages that are available in the game. So you simply could follow the paths around, and that will take you to the different villages. But the first thing I recommend you do is get familiar with a few of the keys. We'll start with the tab key. This is going to bring up a menu that you're going to spend a lot of time on. So let's go ahead and look at it. First is your inventory. The game starts us out with a few basics. We start out with a little bit of coin, just in case we want to buy something at the very beginning, such as seeds or maybe a tool. Then we have some basics for food. We have some basic clothing and then a torch for getting around at night. So some of the basics there. And of course, as we gather more resources and tools, they will show up here. And then you have your hotbar over on the right-hand side that you can fill up with various weapons and tools as you move along. The information at the bottom of the screen here, we're actually going to see on our main screen as we're moving around. So we'll focus more on that when we get out there. But you're going to have things in here such as your health, stamina, your temperature. As long as you're in the green, that means that your body temperature is okay. But as you start to get too hot or too cold, you're going to want to make sure you have the proper clothing as well as the shelter to take care of those things. Now moving on to the skills. And the skills are tied very closely to technology. So as you're improving your skills, you're also going to be unlocking new technology. But first, let's talk a little bit about the skills themselves. So you have your basic skills across the top, which are extraction. Extraction is basically gathering resources, things like mining rocks or chopping down trees. That's extraction. And the more of those things you do, the quicker you're going to gain different skill points that you can use to unlock various things on the skill tree. Next, we'll move on to hunting. Hunting is exactly the way it sounds. The more you hunt from things such as rabbits, deer, and so on, that's going to improve your skills, give you more skill points that you can spend in here. Now, I'm going to do a separate video where I focus on some ways and tricks to improve these skills at a much faster rate, but the basics are always going to be the same. If you want to improve these skills, then simply do these things that it talks about within the skill tree. So then we move on to farming. And this is one in particular that I had struggle with in the early game because it takes a while until you really get into the farming. You're going to need a little bit of money so that you can buy seeds and so on. So I'm going to show you a trick in the separate video that will really help you to get your farming skill upgraded much quicker than the game would normally allow. Then we get to diplomacy. This is simply talking to people, performing quests from folks, buying and selling from vendors, that type of thing. Then we get to survival and finally production. So these are things you're definitely going to be doing throughout the game. Production is things like crafting weapons, crafting tools, and so on. Then let's move over real quickly to technology since it is tied so closely. So obviously the more of these things that you're doing during the game, more gathering resources, crafting tools and weapons and building and so on, you're going to unlock different buildings along the way. So we have a few different tabs, starting with building technology. This is in large part tied to extraction, as well as the building itself, as you might imagine. So as you're doing things like building homes for yourself and NPCs that you invite to your village, that's going to increase your building technology. And once you reach certain levels that you see alongside here, you will unlock different buildings. Okay, but also extraction. Extraction is very important. So as you're gathering resources, things like, again, mining rocks that you find in the game world or chopping down trees, it's going to also improve this building technology. In fact, one of the easiest and quickest ways that I have found to increase the building technology is simply go mining. It has given me a lot of technology points that have been very helpful. And then survival technology. So as you go hunting or start fishing, laying traps, all of those types of things are going to improve your skill in this area. And then farming. So again, as you plant crops, plant orchards, whether it's tilling the land or planting the crops or harvesting the crops, all of those activities are going to give you points that will eventually allow you to unlock the various items in the game. And then finally, production. The more crafting you do, one of the very first buildings you're going to have is a workshop. And in a separate video, I'll show you exactly how you can use that workshop and the items you can craft in there to greatly accelerate how quickly you can make it through some of these different items and get them unlocked so you can add them to your village. So all of these are very important and will take time, but there are certain aspects that the game is simply not going to tell you up front, and that's what we'll have this series of videos to uncover that information, and I'll share with you what I've learned so far. Then we come to the journal tab. This is where you're going to see the quests that are available to you. You're going to have certain challenges available, and then you're going to have side quests. Side quests are things that you pick up from different NPCs around the game world. Then you're going to have story quests. There are certain main characters in the game world which will give you quests, and they generally have a storyline that you'll be able to follow over multiple seasons and multiple years. Those will show up there. And then you have your chapters. So if I click here, starting a new life, this is the very first one you will get, and it will tell you what is your objective, a bit of a description about the objective, and then what are the rewards for completing this. Now, the chapters that you encounter generally have no deadline, so you are under in no hurry to have to complete these within a certain season or a certain number of years. The same thing generally applies to the main story quests that you'll receive as well, but again, just pay attention to each quest that you get and make sure that it doesn't have a deadline attached to it. But like I said, in general, the chapters themselves, as you progress through that storyline, which is essentially intended to be your tutorial and introduce you to some different game elements, these generally have no deadline, so you're free to take these at your own pace. In fact, in my gameplay, sometimes I will go a couple of years and never touch any of these. So again, just keep that in mind as you're moving forward. So here it tells us at the very beginning, it wants us to go and talk to the Castilian who is in a nearby village, which gives us an opportunity to move on to the map. And this is where you can see all of the villages, and you also have an opportunity to place down your own targets. So by default right now, you can see that if we zoom in using the mouse wheel in and out, that this is the Castilian. This is where he's located. He's in Gustavia. And as the game progresses and you move around the map, you're going to have an opportunity to see that there are going to be a lot of potential quests out here that you can go to that particular village and choose to start that quest if you so desire. Or you can simply ignore all of them, which is generally what I do for the most part. So here it wants us to go right here on the map to Gustavia, talk to the Castilian, and that will start the tutorial gameplay through the game. But remember, there is no hurry in doing any of this. So as we're here on the map, you can see the general layout and size. The map isn't overall all that huge. You can walk from side to side pretty quickly. I don't know exactly the number of minutes it will take, but let's say that it's not huge, but I believe it's plenty big for what it needs to be here on the map. This is going to be very important when you start thinking about where do you want to start your settlement, and that'll be a separate video and where we'll talk about that very idea. Where do you want to start the settlement? why would you want to put it there? Maybe some pros and cons to some different locations here on the map. But overall, the message is there is no wrong place to put your village. It all is determined by what you want to accomplish and what sort of activities that you want to undertake in the game. The final tab we want to look at briefly is the management tab. Now, at the very beginning of the game, there's nothing in here because this is tied exclusively to the city building portion of the game. So as you start to invite villagers to join your settlement, this is where all that information is going to be contained. And this is where you're going to spend a lot of time because it's going to give you the basic information, which is what you see over here, from how many dynasty reputation points you have. The number of reputation points you have is going to determine how many people that you can have in your village and how many buildings you're allowed to have. So more dynasty reputation points, the better. Then it's going to tell you how much wood do you need and how much food do your settlers or inhabitants need, as well as a running total for the amount of taxes that you have accrued so far to that year, your development stage, population, and the number of buildings. So again, all of this will be much more important once you get into the city building aspect of the game. But for right now, there's no need to spend a lot of time there other than to understand that it is going to be very important later on in the game. So now that we've taken a look at the tab key and the menu options that it opens up, next I'm going to hit Q. And that's going to bring up some options that, again, you're going to be using quite a bit throughout the game. So we start at the very bottom is exit. So once you're done in here, you can exit out or just simply hit escape. Then we moved into handcrafting. Especially early on in the game, you're going to spend a lot of time in here because this is where your basic tools and weapons are held. These are the tools and weapons that you can produce without needing a specific building, such as the smithy, in order to produce. So as you move throughout the game and you unlock copper tools and ultimately iron tools, you're going to need a separate building in order to craft those. But at the very beginning of the game, some basic wood and stone tools and weapons, you're going to craft those in here. And then as you spin the wheel around, it'll show you exactly what you need. Okay, so as we back out of there, let's go over to the building option. Now, this wheel is where you're going to begin the city building portion. At the very bottom, you have the houses. So you have a few different types of houses that you can build, not only for yourself, but also for the NPCs you invite to your village. Then you have various production type buildings from extraction. This is where you will have woodcutters, people who will gather various resources. Then you have hunters that will go out and grab different resources as well as food items such as meat. Then you get into farming. This is where you'll build a barn. You will build your different fields and so on. Animal husbandry. As you move throughout the game, you will unlock different animals that you're allowed to keep in your village. You'll start with things like chickens, then you'll move up into things like pigs, cows, and so on as the game progresses. All of that can be found back on the tab menu that we were just in, if you're wondering exactly how long it's going to take and how many points you're going to need in technology before you can unlock a certain building. That's where you'll find that information. Then we get into production building. This is going to be crafting some of the different items, some of the weaving that you'll do and sewing and that kind of thing. All of that will be found on this wheel. And then finally, you have your storages. You'll need to have a separate storage for all of the food that you want to keep for your villagers. And then there will be a different storage entirely for the various resources that are not related to food. So all of these are found within this wheel. So once again, you'll spend a lot of time working your way through this wheel as you begin to do a lot of building. Then you have some of the more ornamental things such as fences and different furniture and decorations. I spend almost no time in these. These are more for the visual of the game and making it feel more like home or a village. But these are things you can unlock and spend some time there. And then once you get into building, you can create your own roads that run throughout your village and make it a little bit more aesthetically pleasing as you move throughout the game world. One other thing that I will point out is the M key. If you want to go straight into the map, you can press the M key rather than going through the tab function. But I did want to mention that as we get moving. The final thing I want to talk about in today's introductory video are the basic resources. Now, you might not realize it, but where we've spawned in has all of the basic resources that we're going to need to get started. So the first thing, as we look around, I see sticks. Now, you're going to find sticks in one of two ways. First is if you walk up to some of these what look like smaller trees or bushes, you'll see the opportunity. If I simply hold down the E key, I collect sticks. In that case, I got two sticks from that. And any of these small trees or look like small bushes, these are available. You can collect those for sticks. Also, you're going to see sticks just laying around on the ground. In this case, I don't have to hold down the E key. I can simply press E and pick that one up off the ground. So very easy to collect sticks that way. And then, as you might imagine, we're going to need wood. And the way you're going to collect wood, simply walk up to a tree, and you can see it shows 100%, meaning that we have not chopped at this tree at all. But what do we require in order to chop down the tree? We need an axe. And so we can simply press the Q key, come into our handcrafting menu, and go to the axe on the wheel. And it says we need 10 sticks and 2 stones. So very basic tools and how to craft them early on in the game. But you're going to find a lot of opportunity. You're never going to be low on opportunities to find sticks, wood, or stone. Which brings me to the discussion about stone. Stones you're also going to find on the ground. In fact, let's move around a little bit and see if we see any laying around. I will tell you that during certain parts of the year, spring and summer in particular, it can be hard to find stones laying on the ground unless you're nearby the water. If you happen to find yourself around the beach, then it makes it a little easier to find them. But in and amidst all this brush, they can be hard to spot. So as we're moving around, keep in mind, you'll find some stone on the ground, but by far and away, the easiest way to get stone will be to simply find rock on the game map. And as I get closer, you can see it requires a pickaxe. So once again, we'll press on Q, go to handcrafting, and what we need for a stone pickaxe, we need 1 log and 4 stone. Now, logs are obtained by chopping down trees. Each tree will give you a certain number of logs. Every type of tree will give you a different number of logs, so keep that in mind. Some of the trees, like birch, will only give you a couple, whereas some of the other types will give you 3, 4, or even more, depending on the tree. So as we move along, we're finding lots of sticks. I see both on the ground as well as along the way. It looks like this is a rock. There's some rocks over here. Yep, there's some stones right there. I can simply press down the E key and collect the stones. So you're going to find this all over the entire map. So plenty of opportunities for sticks and stones as well as logs. So now that we know how to obtain those, let's talk a little bit about the wild animals. Because obviously we're going to need food and water at the beginning of the game. So a couple of ways to obtain food is, before you get into farming, one way is to hunt, because if we come into the handcrafting window, we have a knife, and you'll definitely want to get one of these as early as possible. You can see it doesn't take very many resources to make, because you'll use this to skin and field dress the animal after you kill it. That's how you'll obtain the meat and other resources from the animal. And then you've got your spears. You can throw spears at the animal in order to kill them. And you can see they take logs, which is extremely expensive. But with trees not exactly being a scarce resource on the map, it shouldn't be all that big of an issue. So the wild animals in general are found at certain parts of the map. So if we pull up our map, you're going to find some of the more common animals like rabbits and deer. You're going to find them all over the map. They're pretty much everywhere. But then some of the more scarce, such as bears. Bears are found in the mountainous areas and are pretty rare. I have had times where I've walked through the areas where I know bears spawn, like right up in the mountains, and it's taken me several minutes to find one. So bears are pretty scarce, but they will attack as soon as you see them, so it's worth knowing where they spawn. But again, in the mountain areas is where you're going to find the bears. You'll find wolves scattered around the map in different areas, but generally wooded areas. So like this area where you're out sort of in the open, you're generally not going to see wolves or bears out in these areas. But you might find some of the more common animals such as rabbits or deer out here. So if you're interested in hunting, then making the spears early on and getting good at throwing spears at animals will be a very good skill to learn. Another thing you can do is find berries. And next, we're going to talk a little bit about where and how to find those berries. All right, you can see it started to get dark a little bit in the game world. So you'll go through a complete day-night cycle. Now, I have walked over to a small wooded patch. In case you're wondering, we were just right over there on the path. So I didn't walk very far at all. But early game, when you're looking for food other than hunting, you can find berries. So I've walked over and I noticed this large patch of bushes. These are berry bushes, and you're going to find these as you walk throughout the game map. So just, I wanted to show you exactly what they look like. Now, during the summertime is the only time you can pick the actual berries that are ripe to eat. So if I hold down the E key and collect, you notice in the top left-hand corner, it says unripe berry. And if we hop into the tab key and then inventory, you notice that we have picked unripe berries. And at the bottom of the screen, it says, yes, it'll give us a little bit of food, but it'll also give us poisoning. And you're going to need to deal with that. So I highly recommend leaving those berries alone until you get to summer. Because remember, it gives you some food to get you started off. And the dried meat is going to last you a little while, as well as the rolls. So I highly recommend getting good at hunting, throwing those spears at things like rabbits early on, because that will be a great sustainable food source early in the game. But then again, you're going to find berry bushes throughout the game world, and you can grab those very handy during the summer. And then the final thing we need to mention, because we've already talked about the resources that you're going to need early game and how to get them, we've also talked about food and hunting. The last thing is water. All you have to do is simply come to any body of water, whether it's one of the streams, a pond, or one of the bigger bodies of water, hold down the E key, and you will be able to drink and fill your water. So in the bottom left-hand corner is where you're going to see your health, your stamina, and your food and water. So that is should be everything you need to get yourself started. And now, of course, the game, you look at the top of the screen on the compass, and it's telling me this way to the Castilian to get this thing going. So that's going to do it for today. Thank you guys so much for joining me, and stick around for more Medieval Dynasty.